Paradigm. Paradigm is the way we see the world. A paradigm shift is a very hard thing for people. When they go from, this is how I've always done it, to a new way of doing it, shifting their paradigm isn't easy. So as far as effectiveness of Christian men, one of our biggest goals is to shift them to thinking that, you know, from thinking that meat's the way to bananas is the way. Now, I've learned over a long period of time that my sports when I coached was measured to a thousandth of a second. And we coaches really, really get along. It's really amazing because we really want to win a lot. And we win by a thousandth of a second. If you're third by a thousandth of a second at Olympic trials, you stay home and watch TV just like everybody else. A thousandth of a second. And it really does happen a lot. About 0.5 of a second and you're in 8th place versus 1st place. And many times in the 50, a lot closer than that. So everything's measurable what we do. Production versus production capability. I didn't talk about this last time. If you just worry about production, just worry about getting the job done, and don't take care of yourself, and we'll talk about that next time, is one of the habits of effective people is to take care of yourself. If you don't take care of yourself, and you don't take care of your prayers, and you don't go back to God, and all you worry about is making money or whatever it is, production, then pretty soon you have no production. You have to have a great balance. So we'll talk a little about that. Now, the thing I did differently this time is, in between this time and last time, I was so convicted that I can't get through all of this that I put it online. So all of these notes are online, more things are online, a few more movies are online. I did that all because I do that as part of what I do for a living. So it doesn't print very well, we learned, but it is something you can do. Now, it's essential as we go into the next three habits that we realize that if you haven't done the first half, the second half isn't going to work. You be proactive. You're not one of those people that reacts to everything. You're the one, once you have a mission, you be proactive about it. You decide what the measurement is, and then you're accountable to yourself, and you become accountable, if you're smart, to other people in an interdependent paradigm. You begin with the end in mind. Number two here, begin with the end in mind. Keep that end in mind. And what you were talking about last time, it might be you picture yourself at 99 years old, 105 years old, whatever it is, looking back on your life. And I have a company that interviews people. It's called the Living Legacy Interviews on their life. And it's really sad when people look at me kind of with a blank stare and I have to pull things out of them. And basically, it's only stories, but it's not really me. You know, it's not really, gosh, I set this goal to be the best possible parent and my kids are wonderful and whatever. And that's when it really starts to feel really great. I prayed and God answered my prayer. Well, you start hearing that. And sometimes it's empty, though. And that's really sad. So that can be changed in a heartbeat. And that's a really good thing. You put the first things first. Once you've done those first two things, now you know what the first things are, right? And I always talk to people, this is a Tony Robbins thing, is sort of more him than Covey, but it's a really good idea to think about. What one thing could you do today, right now, in the next 5 minutes, that could promote the most important goal in your life? Because a lot of people, a lot of men, a lot of women, a lot of people put a list of things to do, and they check it off as if that's a really great thing. At the end of the day, you still feel kind of empty, even though you checked them all off. Because it wasn't the things that really mattered to you most. I think I quoted Dobson last time in saying that the average father spends 2-point-something minutes a day of quality interactive time with his son, and yet, if you ask him what's his most important priority, what's his most important thing heart-wise, you know, one-to-one, so he's not lying. He says, it's my son, it's my kids. There's a disconnect there, isn't there? Christian men shouldn't have that disconnect, should we? We really shouldn't have that disconnect. Boy, we live in a world where it's very easy to disconnect. So let's reconnect. It seems that simple. So, I'm going to hold here, and you've got a piece of paper on your table, and I want you to take a quick look at it. We're going to go through really fast what each other has. First, somebody has. Who has? What would you do if you knew you could not fail? Who has that one? Okay, so what they're going to do, and they can share this with you later, but what they're going to do is they're going to write down one thing or more that they would do. It didn't matter. The resources were unlimited. There was no scarcity. Money just was not a problem. Always we think about money first, don't we? Time was not a problem. I mean, everybody has 168 hours a week. Steve Jobs did, and we do, right? Jesus did for 3 years, 36 months, did a heck of a lot, right? God is outside of time. So you're pretending time is not a problem. You're pretending money's not a problem. You're pretending you have all the relationships you need. What would you do if you knew you couldn't fail? It's really something you really think you should do. It doesn't matter, but I mean, just don't limit yourself, okay? It might be what you're presently doing. Who has emotional bank account? Name one best thing you could do to improve the emotional bank account of one person today. Something you could do to lift them up and make them know how much you love them or respect them, admire them. Something you could do to make that relationship better. So you guys, who has that? Okay, so you guys are working on that. Go ahead. And you might want to see what everybody else is doing, but you keep on that. Who is the major influence in your life? What values and principles do they exhibit? Just kind of, who has that one? Okay, so think about somebody that you know, you can really use as a role model. And we're churchy, so we think Jesus Christ. I mean, absolutely. But think about Paul, right? What an amazing thing to stand there in Greece, the only Christian. Just, you know, I think about Paul's, and they're just amazing. Some people are thinking right now about Steve Jobs, some people, whatever. Who and what values do they have that you most admire? Who has values, principles, and mission statement? Did anybody do their mission statement last week? Did you get the link? Did anybody get the link from Jim? Okay, well, there's a, you can go on the Covey side and do your personal mission statement. I encourage you to do that. It doesn't have to be on their side. There's plenty of those things around. But who has a personal mission statement? Is anybody in here done that? One? Wow. You will love it. You will love it if you do this. Just sit down and decide what your personal mission is. It's a great experience that you have with yourself. And once you do that, it's much easier to put the first things first. I'm not sure it's possible if you haven't done it. You know, I'm kind of throwing darts. If your life ever feels that way, just kind of retreat a little bit and go, okay, what's most important to me? And if I had to have a couple of lines, I don't mean like Ford, quality is job one. I've had some Fords where somebody didn't read the thing on the wall. This role and priority-driven calendar. This calendar is something I'll send you. It's an Excel interactive spreadsheet, and I think, I don't know if I sent that to Jim to send to you. It's really great when it's in Excel because it's totally interactive. We'll go through it again, but just put your roles on the left side there, but it's really hard to see. Your roles go down here, the roles of your life. Like I happen to be a swim coach, I happen to own a software company, and an interview company, and a bunch of other stuff I do. And so those are my roles. I'm a husband. I'm a father. And it doesn't matter if you get them right now. What you know, 1, 2, 3, and 4. That doesn't matter. Just put your roles really fast. Who has that one?
We do.
You do. Okay. So, and all of you should have a sheet like that. I passed out last time. If you need it, I'll give you another one. And if you need it interactive, it's really cool because I think it is. Everybody gets 168 hours a week. This is going to shock you. It does everybody when I do this. There's 168 hours a week, the same amount as the president or the premier or the CEO of the biggest company you can possibly think of that gets more done than many of us. We all have the same amount of time, right, a week. We sleep, let's say we sleep 8 hours a day, which I haven't done that in a while. But that gives us 112 waking hours. If you were to work 8 hours a day for 5 days a week, you would have 10.3 average waking hours a day to do whatever you want. Now, I just want that to resonate. 10.3 hours to do whatever you want, besides 40 hours of work, which, you know, it's modern day, maybe that doesn't happen. Plus, take out the sleep, and I hear people tell me they don't have time to do what they really care about the most, all the time. I do this a little more, but I hear it all the time. I've always wanted to, and that's what you guys are doing, right? Always wanted to, maybe that's something, maybe that's what you always wanted to do. I always wanted to build, I always wanted to get involved in. And yet, there's people doing it. Not you, why? Maybe we're sitting in front of a screen too much, huh? I don't know. And that's what's great about this calendar, is you start figuring out what really matters to you. If I had to open your checkbook right now and take a look at it, it's a good idea, it's a good thing. Look at it, what is most, if I didn't know you, what's most important to you? I'd be able to tell. If I looked at your calendar of what you really did last week, what is really most important to you? Not what you say, but what's really most important. A lot of times there's a disconnect. But you know what? You can reconnect that fast. You have to go to some psychologist for 25 years, you can reconnect. Boom, just like that. Completely changed, just like that. That's how long it takes. It's how long it took Paul, and it's as long as it's going to solve, and it's as long as it takes us if we know it. So I don't know if I'm saying something new, or it's an epiphany to you. If it is, it's wonderful. I mean, it's funny how by this time next week, somebody could come up to me, and it happens. They can come up to me and go, you know, I've always wanted to, and I did it. I picked up the phone. I knew somebody that did that. Things started to open up. It's like God put them right in my way. No, they were there the whole time. I try not to tell them that. Okay, you have 5 minutes. Please interact with each other on what you're doing. Oh, you guys, four quadrants. Sorry, let me see. Four quadrants. Here we go. Here's the quadrants. Here's your choices. You can do really urgent things all your life. Crises, pressing problems, screaming, yelling, fits, whatever. That's the urgent and important, right? I'm going to leave you. Okay, well, suddenly that becomes important. And that becomes urgent, okay? And before that time, hopefully we're working on the emotional bank account, and that's not going to happen. But number three is activities. Interruptions, some phone calls, some mail, you know, junk mail, all that other stuff. Some meetings. Oh, gosh, but we have a lot of meetings and trying to set up Canyon Hills Friends, church men's. Meetings to have meetings about meetings to have meetings. They're still doing it. I don't know if we should do Saturday. I want to wring their necks, and they want to wring mine. Proximate, pressing matters, popular activities. Popular activities. A lot of popular activities keep us from our real mission, huh? Number four is trivia. So that's not urgent, not important. Stay out of number four. Some mail, some phone calls, time wasters, people to get on the phone with you. You have to be able to say no. It's easy to say no when there's a greater yes. But if you don't know your personal mission, what's your greater yes? So take some time with that, I recommend. Here's where you need to be. Quadrant two, work that is not urgent yet. Not urgent yet. So you're building a foundation, right? Prevention and improvement. Taking care of your health. Improvement of your company. Improvement of your relationships. Relationship building. Recognizing new opportunities and planning and some recreation. Not recreation, we go out and play football right now and four of us get broken arms. That's not me. All right? Yeah, there's a saying, the older I get, the better I was. You have to be careful when that comes onto the field, you're a little. Okay, so that's what you guys are working on. Okay? Now, 5 minutes, go. First things first, first your pants, then your shoes, I love that. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish. Pretty empowering, isn't it? Pretty empowering, guys, huh? Okay, we worked on that. Okay, there's more of this online, we're going to fly through, and now, those were the first three habits. Without that foundation, the rest of this is meaningless. without the foundation of knowing who you are and what your mission is and what you're here for and praying on that and knowing that, the rest is irrelevant. Okay? That's why we went backwards today. Now we're going to fly through this. Now all of these notes are online. And as someone said, very difficult to print. So I will do my best. And what I will do, if you email me, I'll send you a Word or whatever that you can print easily. Okay?
10habits.com.
Yeah, 10habits.com. It's all for you. It'll actually have us there.